And then I was shown this other reality or dimension or potential for the world. And it was so, so beautiful. And it was just around the corner. It wasn't like, you know, this could happen if we're really good in 500 years. There was a simplicity to it, and there was a beauty to it, and there was an ordinariness to it. And what was most significant is the sense of joy returned again to life.
I was, if you will, remembering what I had forgotten very intentionally in order to be on this planet, which is what we all do. In point of fact, I don't think that this planet exists. It's a figment of our imagination, if you will, and we have a very good imagination. We're incredibly creative beings.
We are amazing, magnificent, powerful beings, because I felt my energy, my essence was so huge and powerful and amazing, powerful beyond my imagination, beyond anything I could ever have known before.
It's kind of interesting, you know, when we're in the light, we have available all the consciousness of all the souls that ever were and all the souls that ever will be. We have this expanded knowing that we have available to us that we're a part of.
When you cross over, you're privy to all of the universal information. You might not retain it when you come back, but you are there in it in that moment. You are connected to all there is and all that is.
I was aware of everything that was going on around me. I was aware of everything the doctors were doing, all the conversations that were taking place. I was aware of my family, my husband standing or sitting by my bedside, and my mother. My mother was praying to Shiva and Ganesha. My husband was just sitting by my bedside holding my hand and watching the dials above my bed, willing for me to come back. But I was also aware of what they were feeling, and I was aware of everything that even the doctors were feeling, and the nurses, and everybody who was treating me. It was like I shared their same essence, like I could feel, like I shared their consciousness.
As I wandered, I encountered all the doctors, nurses, the patients, the families, the people around them. And there was a new knowing about everyone I looked at. I knew them. I knew them perfectly. I knew their love, their hate, their joy, their peace, their decisions, their motivations. It was as if I was connected to them. There was a oneness. I was them.
In an instant, I was suddenly conscious, suddenly massively conscious. And I was conscious just not of a self, but of all of those around me, of their inner thoughts, of their inner motivations, of their inner beings, of their inner realities, of all those that cared for me.
Pure light, love, truth, grace, peace, all consciousness, all knowingness, and having left the body way behind, and even the mind, the spirit starts to experience complete oneness with all that ever was, ever will be, and all that is, and complete understanding of all of it. Imagine such consciousness.
Just like that, I pictured myself leaving the Earth, and I pictured myself out in space looking at the Earth from not a considerable distance, but, you know, there's the Earth right in front of me. And what's was so strange about looking at the earth like that was that at that moment, you could have asked me any given moment in my life, because I just relived it, but you could have asked me any given moment in any person's life on that planet, and I could have told you. All of that information was right there. It was available. Not just any person living there now, any person that had ever lived there or ever would live there. All that information is all available. It's right there. For the moment, back to where I was. I'm out in space and I'm looking at the Earth and I'm knowing what's going on with everybody's life in it. And then because everybody has always told me, and I'm still somewhat referencing things, of course, but in earthly terms, I'm looking at it and saying, well, I guess it's time for me to move on and go to the other place. So in my mind, I pictured turning away from the Earth and going out into space. Of course, you're wondering, where am I going next? I don't have a direction. I don't know that I'm in space. I don't know where I would travel to if I was. So where is it I'm going?
As I tell my story, it's going to sound like a progressive series of events. And it's going to sound like I'm talking about places and things. But when we leave our bodies, there's no space. There's no up, down, sideways, back and forth. None of that exists anymore. And there's no time either. There's no past or future. And I have a couple of phrases, you know, I've had a long time to think about how to explain what it felt like. And what it feels like to be in a position of no time, no past or future is, it's a perpetual unfolding of now.
And it felt as though time and space was very different in that realm. It was as though I could be anywhere at any time. There was no time lapse, like I could travel any distance and there would be no time lapse. It was as though everything was happening simultaneously. The best way I can describe it is as though I was viewing my life or lives. It was as though I could see what were past lives plus my future, and I could see it all happening simultaneously, as though I was viewing a tapestry. And this is what I mean about it happening all at once. Like when you're viewing a tapestry, you see the entire completed tapestry. There's no time lapse between the time you see this color or this part and that part. I was able to see it all at once. It was as though all my lives were happening simultaneously. Everything was just so clear, and it was like I was one thread woven in that tapestry. I could see where I had been, I could see where I had yet to go, but I could also see there were choices, that if I went this way, this would happen, and if I went this way, this would happen. And there were parts of the tapestry that were still unfinished. I could see all the lives I had already touched and all the lives that I had yet to touch.
Now, another thing that's very important to understand is that time flow in that gateway realm is very different from time flow here. That's one of the reasons why those life reviews, the memories are not just vague memories, but very strong, powerful learning opportunities where the goods and bads of our life and what we've done to others, feeling the impact of our decisions on others, is so hyper-real. And we go through it, like they say, you know, flashes before your eyes. And the amazing thing is it doesn't take anything of Earth time. It could happen in a second, or it could take a century to unfold. It doesn't matter. Because time flow and causality in that realm is a much higher order than in this realm.
Suddenly, I became aware that nothing went unnoticed. Not a thought, not an intention, not a moment, not a tear shed, not a smile, not a blink. Nothing in our lives goes unnoticed, and that every moment of my life, as is true for all of us, I was being showered with this unconditional, this great and creative force, this tremendous power of God or of love.
Then we felt like we were going to move, and we moved into the light, into this area that to me it felt spherical, and we moved inside this sphere. And when we were in there, we started to relive my life. And when I say we relived my life, I mean I got to experience it like I had relived it, but also through everyone I'd ever had any interaction with, I got to see it through their perspective. And so it was like my consciousness split into these multiple streams of consciousness, and I was able to look at my life from all these different angles. And I got to see every action that I had created with these people, how it affected them and how it created these ripples. And these ripples felt like they were cascading beyond the sphere and into the light itself.
And it was as if every action were a stone thrown into a pond of water. And those actions had effect on every living individual in one way or another, even though we couldn't, in this physical life, truly perceive that. And so you can imagine every action that was loving that I relived through my own choice and then through the effect that it had on the people that I interacted it with, and then through the people that they then interacted with, and so on and so on and so on, seen throughout all physical reality. Every choice and every action that was loving became incredibly glorious, that was loving in a selfless sense, and in an unconditional sense. And every action that was selfish became as nothing, really. It was as if I were dead at that moment. And every action that were motivated in any way that could be considered or construed as being cruel or with a cruel thought even became incredibly hurtful. And I relived this not just as myself, but again as every person that it had ever impacted, but from a greater point of consciousness.
I also used to have a belief that it would get so bad that God would just come and fix it all. Burn it up and start over, maybe. We get to change it. We get to fix it. It will start in unconditional love. Now, this is a relatively small group of people in a beautiful, remote little corner of the world. But as we connect, as we go out in absolute unconditional love, it ripples out and it changes the whole world. It literally changes the whole world. Are you feeling a shift? Who's aware of the shift that's happening? I mean, you can see it in the world. There's turmoil. There's all kinds of things that we get to look at. But it's shifting if we'll tap into that, starting with that unconditional love and just ripple that out.
Everything we say or do affects everybody else in the world. It's like throwing a pebble into water. The ripples just go out and we don't realize it. We're that powerful and that synergistically connected, because we all come from one place.
And I got to see those rough patches, you might say, but I also got to see where whenever I would do something with just loving intention, that it would create some of the biggest ripples. Some of the biggest ripples. It was, I mean, that was incredible joy to be able to experience those moments. So I got to see the good, the bad. My soul family were supporting me through the whole thing. I got to see how, when I would do something, how it would affect somebody and how it, you know, maybe shift something in them. We don't realize how interconnected we are with each other, and I got to see that. I got to see how when we reach out to each other, or when we push away from each other, how it affects each and every one of us.
Each and every one of you, while you're here, you are going to make a ripple, and it is going to affect mankind. But here's the interesting part. God said to me, free will, you get to choose if you let your light shine or not. But you're still going to make a ripple. So you can choose to make that ripple with the light on, the light off. And the light is the connection with God, that love connection. Can you imagine if a bunch of us make that ripple and we choose to have that love connection and the light shine? I saw what happens when we do. It's not about one of us, it's about all of us coming together. We each shine our light and we make that ripple. That's when we will change everything.
And there are no churches there, not where I was. It wasn't about just one way, and it wasn't about doctrines and books, but just about a universal compassion and love for everything, for everyone. Animals, plants, birds, all of it.
The love I felt in the other realm, it doesn't matter where or who it was coming from, because all of us have different philosophies of how we like to see life. I don't like to put labels on anything. So whether the love comes from Jesus or Allah or Krishna or Buddha, it doesn't matter. Whether it came from my father, it's all God. The love was still unconditional. And that love that I felt told me that I was deserving and I was worthy of being loved. And it made me realize that it's okay to love myself.
I know this is not a farce, but it's school. We're all here to learn. We're all here to do better and be better. How you treat others and stuff. Oh, and there's no religion. That's the other thing. If you go there, there's no religion. There's no priest, there's no rabbi, there's no bishop, there's nothing. It does not matter. Nothing. So when I hear someone say, well, you're going to hell because you're not this and this, I'm like, trust me, you're in such a surprise when you get there. Because it's so not relevant. It's just not relevant.
And I remember suddenly becoming excited, like I could ask, I know what I want to ask. Because I come from a background where it was a lot of, it's this is what it is, and it's not that, and this is what's true, and it's and this isn't, or this is the one that's the right one, and those don't have it all, and things like that. So I was like, well, here it is. I want to ask, and I kind of went up, and I didn't even have to ask because the question that was there in my mind, well, which one is the true church? He It was already in his understanding that it was in my mind. And at the same time that I was feeling this question, I was in his place, seeing myself from his wisdom and knowledge and background. And the way I saw myself asking was like a little kid who goes up to someone with maybe some more wisdom or knowledge. And it was as if I were saying, so tell me, which kind of cheese is the moon made of? Is it Jack, Swiss, or cheddar?
It was like, this is for everybody. What your particular preference was on this or that in terms of your politics or your religion didn't seem to be a big issue at all. Do you love each other? Do you care about each other? Do you help each other? Those were the basic things that I came away with. Not are you from the Lutheran Church and I'm from the Catholic Church and I don't know if I can talk with you. I mean, do we have anything in common here?
But, you know, there's the big questions in life that we all have. I can tell you one thing. One of the big questions, I think, is probably one of the oldest questions is, okay, if God is a good, loving God, then how is it possible that he could allow the evil and the horror that obviously exists? How is that possible if he really does, if God is pure love? And so I think that religions had to invent an anti-God to explain that. Oh, that's not God, that's the devil doing that stuff, right? Well, that means God made the devil too. You know, so, I mean, it doesn't add up. But I can tell you one thing for sure. There was no judgment. There was no atonement. There was nothing that I had ever done that was completely forgiven. And forgiven in that context meant it was gone. It did not exist. You know, the stupid little boneheaded things I've done in my life that were, have been, you know, well, let's just say less than wonderful. I didn't have to atone for that. God wasn't holding me accountable for that. God was loving me right through it, and it was total and complete forgiveness.
I start watching kind of in 360 technicolor in the atmosphere around me all of the events of my life unfold, and it was incredible. The great decisions that I had made, the contributions that I had made, the little small things that I'd done to make somebody's day, and then there were the things where I hadn't used great judgment. And the one thing that really sticks out that just tickles me and shows me that the universe has this incredible sense of humor is there were these cringeworthy moments, absolutely, where you knew what was coming. And if I have to tell you that there was any kind of experience or any kind of negative aspect of the experience, that was it, and it's not even negative. It's that kind of, ooh, I see what's coming up, and I know what I did there. And you're looking around, well, who's judging this? That, you know, I was taught my whole life that somebody was going to be judging. So, you know, and I'm looking, and it's still just me and my cheerleaders, my guardians. And I'm like, wait a minute, this isn't how I was taught this works.
So I know other experiencers have described hellish experiences, and I don't know what that's about. I don't know what that's about, but I can tell you that in my experience, there was nothing of the sort, nothing resembling hell. Although, the first part where, of my experience where I was in the void and I was getting confused and scared and ramping up and getting very frightened, if I had been revived at that point, I would have called that a hellish experience. It was that scary. Maybe that's part of the explanation for it. I don't know. There's a lot I don't know.
The experiences are very negative. From my point of view,
And again, part of this is from my own experience. Those who've read the book Proof of Heaven realize that I started out in a very primitive, kind of dark, underground, foreboding realm that I call the earthworm's eye view. If I had come back from my near-death experience having just been to the earthworm eye view, I probably would have had what people describe as a hellish near-death experience, hellish NDE. And my own view, and this is not just from my experience, although my experience clearly supports it, but also from talking with many other near-death experiencers and reviewing thousands of near-death experience cases, I believe that in many ways the hellish ones are incomplete.
You know, any near-death experience or mystical experience or out-of-body experience, the universe speaks to us in the language that we'll understand. Even if it doesn't make sense, they know that our heart will get it. And in this instance, I was holding my little boy in a very physical way. And as I did, I felt someone come up behind me. Now, this was so overwhelming, I didn't even dare turn around. What I felt was so cosmic and so powerful and so profound and so wise and yet also so absolutely personal. It startled me at first. There I was holding my son and feeling this presence come up. I knew I was in the presence of God. Nothing short of that. It was so overwhelming. And the interesting thing is I had this moment where I thought, oh no. I hope he forgives me. And what I felt as I held my little boy was this divine being come up and wrap those arms around me and hold me. And the clear message was, there's nothing to forgive. Nothing but love. Absolute, unconditional love just poured through me. And I felt almost as if my son became part of me and I became part of God, and then we all became part of everything there is. It was almost like an inhale of breath and an exhale of bam. I was everything. I was all of it. And again, from my upbringing, the words I am that I am became very, very meaningful to me because I was experiencing I am that.
So I'm looking, there's no judge, and I'm realizing, oh, wait a minute, I'm judging this. Oh. Well, I'm going to be really kind to myself here. And I'm seeing these experiences take place, and the feeling that I'm having is one of empathy for me in the decisions that I made with the tools that I had at the time, and for the other person who's experiencing my lack of judgment at the time, or what we might consider hurtful behaviors. And I'm watching, and I'm kind of very detached, and I'm going, okay, well, if I were doing that again, I might do it this way. And I'm thinking, and I'm integrating those thoughts. And that was it. There was no wrath. There was no judgment. Just this peaceful, loving space of everything's okay. This is perfect.
You know, I actually believe that we can go beyond forgiveness. When we really start to realize that people are doing the best they can with what they know in that moment, regardless of what they've done, it's beyond forgiveness. It's more like empathy, compassion. It's trying to understand where they're coming from. And that goes not just with what other people do, but with yourself. And when you can do it for yourself, it starts to become easier to do it for other people. So start by being more empathic towards yourself. Whenever you do something that you feel you're judging yourself, I mean, how many times do you say things like, oh man, that was so stupid of me, how could I have done that, or I should have done that differently? It's things like that. Watch that self-talk and tell yourself, no, I'm a beautiful child of the universe. I don't deserve to be talked to like that. And start to empathize with yourself. And when you can do that for yourself, you'll start to do that for other people, and you'll realize there's nothing to forgive.
often if you get into the near-death experience literature, you read a lot about the tens of thousands of life reviews that people describe. You know that old saying, your life flashes before your eyes? Well, it's very true, and that's what near-death experiencers tell you, is that you go through every bit of your life, all the crucial parts that are there to teach you about the lessons of good and bad that are still residual lessons for you to learn, to help you and your higher soul and your soulmates, your soul group. And the judgment is not by any higher power, it's by our higher soul. That's what's doing the judging in that realm. And that's when we go through those life reviews, it's not some vague sepia-tinted memory. These are sharp, clear, crisp, absolute, reliving the events more powerfully than when we live through them in the earthly realm. And we have to feel the power of our decisions, the emotional impact on our fellow beings. So if we lived a life handing out pain and suffering to others, we have to feel that in that life review. But we have to feel it far more sharply than they felt it here in the material realm, which is a pale, dim reflection of that far more real and crisp world of that gateway realm, of the realm between lives, where we reunite with our higher souls.
And I also want to add that in the other realm, there's no judgment because there's nothing to judge. We are all love. We're all pure love, unconditional love. So there's nothing to judge. And one of the most controversial things in my book, which many people ask me about, is about the fact that I say that there's no judgment, there's no hell, there's no punishment. When you realize that there's nothing to forgive, then there's nothing to punish either. People who commit acts that take them to prison while we're in physical life, yes, we have prisons here to protect us from people who live in so much fear that they can't be trusted not to cause harm. But when they cross over, they themselves understand in that moment of clarity, they themselves understand that everything they did out of fear. They did because they didn't know any better. Now, if you imagine, if you have a child who you have been punishing because they have been not just reckless, but destructive and harmful to other people, harmful to their siblings. So you have had to reprimand them, punish them, scold them. Now imagine if one day when the child comes to you and says, oh my God, I've had an awakening. I understand. I understand why I did those things and how stupid it was of me. Are you going to burn them in hell for all of eternity? Of course not.
If I was going to try to address the question of whether or not there is a God, I would say to you that if there is a God, first off, what you're doing in your playtime on this playground, he doesn't care about any more than your mom worries about what it is you're doing on a playground if you're simply out there playing a game of ball and nobody's getting hurt and there's no problems.
As I had been taught that I would be judged and I would either be led into heaven or I would be banished to hell or to suffer some place that was outside of heaven. That just, to me, And I don't mean this against anyone else, but that just seems crazy. It makes no sense to me with respect to what I saw. I stood before a being of light that was nothing but unconditional love, that loved me and wanted the best for me. Information in a way that wasn't words, but I was given understandings of things. And the one thing that was very, very clear to me was that our emotions create energy that goes out and affects other people. And what we have to do is get rid of that, transform that negative energy that really comes into the category of either fear, if it's hatred, anger, any of those things, it's fear energy, as opposed to love energy. I had to transform that kind of energy into love and be able to hold that energy of love and project that out into the universe.
I was in this vastness, this described in some literature as the outer darkness, but it was completely illuminated, but there was no light. And I had no body, but I had being, and there was no time and no space and no thing. I had no brain, I had no language, no culture, no heartbeat. But I could think better than I'd ever thought before, as if my brain was no longer in the way of my thinking. And I was in this vast emptiness that extended into infinity in every direction, and I could see in every direction all at once. And in front of me was, if I had a front, was a shimmering door. And it was transparent and translucent. And inside this doorway was a tunnel. And it was immense. It was 100 yards wide and 70 yards tall. Just immense. But remember, everything I say happens in timelessness, so there's no order of events for me, and there's no language to communicate it. But I touched this thing with my being, and I felt it was living. It was like the living God was in it. And as I did that, I heard my name called from deep inside of me. And I knew instantaneously that I was in the presence of God, but not God like I'd ever conceived of before. And it was a voice, but it had no gender, and it had no sound, and it had no language. But it communicated to me directly in the depth of my being. And when my name was called, I knew that God was absolutely present to me, next to me, but I could see everything, but not God. And the voice called my name, and it was the name of my creation. It was the name given to me to make me exist. It wasn't just Peter, it was the ground of my being, as Paul Tillich said.
This being who absorbed me, and I have this download, so now I want to introduce you to my creator, our creator. God, face to face. God didn't have a face, by the way. Remember, there's no stuff there. But he wasn't the guy with the big white beard and the lightning bolts, let me put it that way. And I'll tell you what God looked like, kind of. I've never been able to paint this. I've been trying, and I just can't get it. Yeah, not yet, anyway. So pretend you are the Hubble Space Telescope, And so this is surrounding you on all levels, okay? Everywhere. And you know when you look at a photograph of a galaxy is made up of little points of light, stars, right? Little points of light, jillions of them, right? And in this case, it was infinite. It went on forever. Little points of light. And I was one of those points of light. And we were all connected. And each one of those points of light was every tsetse fly, every snail, every human being, every rock who had ever lived. And that's right, rocks are alive. I can't explain that, but rocks are also made out of love.
And I could see that nothing existed for an instant without purpose. Nothing existed alone. No thought went unnoticed. The intention of no heart went without impact upon every molecule in existence, let alone you can imagine the impact of one heart upon another, even of people who had no connection or way of knowing one another. You could see that the earth was one and that we, as the human body, were one.
Every being who had ever lived was there, and we were all connected. We were all one thing. Now, we were separate. I was still Raymond, me, but I was also we. We collectively together were God. And I had this feeling of, I have all the potential and power of God. I wasn't God, but somehow through the connection with all the other points of light, I was God. So I wasn't God, but I was God. And it was like this one big thought, one big floating sphere of awareness. And we were singing, and I'll never forget this. This was so beautiful. It was worship. That's the best word I can describe it. And it was about love. And it makes music as we understand it, it seemed like a cheap imitation. I could taste it and touch it and swallow it and digest it. And it took on whole other dimensions. And we were singing and we were saying, I love you. We love you. We were worshiping one another with pure, infinite love. And it was the most beautiful thing.
I could also perceive that all reality, all existence, was emanating from a source of light and life and love, and that all physical reality reflected this life and light and love to whatever extent it's possible. At this point, I became so enchanted that I was beyond being, I think, a self. I simply was, and it was as if I were singing my own note in this grand symphony of life and existence that's the earth and all of us. And I began to sing, I am. And it was not a statement of ego or self, it was really a statement of absolute love that by my being, I simply was expressing absolute love and connectedness and unity and harmony with all of existence. And I was adding my particular and absolutely unique note to this grand song of life that reverberated throughout all existence.
It In that realm, I started to understand that when we cross over, not only do we leave behind our physical bodies, our physical biology, our bodies, but with our bodies goes our gender, which we leave behind. We leave behind our race, our culture. We leave behind our ego, our values. All these get left behind. So what crosses over? Our essence, our pure essence, our consciousness. Once you've stripped all these layers and layers of filters away, that essence that is left, that essence is pure, unconditional love. It's just pure before it's been diluted and filtered through all our cultural conditionings and gender conditionings and so on, and ego responses.
What is your life like when you're not here? If you try to define it, you run into problems, because it is so simple that it's best described in English as this: you are. Stop.
It became very clear to me that suffering in this life can very much be a gift. Not necessarily a gift, it's a catalyst, and a catalyst is neutral, but suffering gives us the opportunity to grow spiritually. And if our true reality is spiritual and not physical, and if our physical suffering results in the development of our spiritual being and spiritual qualities, then it can indeed be a gift. Because if you think about it, there's no moment that we can be courageous without the existence of pain and danger. There's no way that we can truly show compassion in this realm of existence unless, unfortunately, someone else may be suffering. There's no way that we can truly have patience, that spiritual quality of patience, and endure unless things are not going according to how we may desire. And so, if as a result of our physical suffering we can develop these eternal, these essential, these everlasting, these non-ephemeral qualities that are going to last beyond our mere 70 years of life, you know, into the next realm, then we are creating our own spiritual being that we're going to take with us. And that is the most glorious of achievements that we can possibly have. So suffering from that perspective gives us the opportunity to exhibit spiritual qualities and can indeed be a gift, not that one brings it on.
And I came from my journey to see that the hardships and difficulties in this life, and I promise you as a neurosurgeon, as a doctor, that very much includes illness and injury. They are gifts. They are opportunity for growth of our soul.
The thing about life, what I learned, is that everything about life is a gift, even the challenges. We're here to experience life, so we're here to even experience the challenges. When I had cancer, I never would have thought that was a gift. I suffered a lot, terribly, and if anybody told me that was a gift, I would have thought it was absolute nonsense because I was suffering so much. But today, I know that was the biggest gift that life could ever have given me, because I wouldn't be standing here today in beautiful Sedona, Arizona, if that hadn't happened to me. Everything in life is a gift in the end. And if it doesn't feel like a gift right now, it means you haven't reached the end yet.
But I would get up every morning and I would try to commune with spirit, because I would allow my morphine and Percocet to dose down so that by morning or early morning, 3:33 exactly, I would have enough clarity to have spirit communication, because the drugs kind of masked it and I didn't like that feeling. So at that magic time, I was able to communicate with spirit, and spirit helped me to realize and to develop this practice of gratitude that I practice every day now for the rest of my life, where I get up in the morning, I haven't even stepped out of bed yet, and I start looking at kind of like a life review, but it's more of a more present review of where I am, the people in my life, what's it going on, and I give thanks. And so I started back with the cancer. I was grateful for the opportunity to go through that pain and that suffering, because I knew there was a lot for me to learn and to grow from all of that.
Without the light and the darkness, the contrast that's inherent in the physical world, if you think about it, if you walk into a room that's flooded with light, and it's also, you know that there's treasures in that room, just very wonderful things that are awaiting you. If you walk into that room and you're completely flooded with light, you won't be able to perceive anything. Your senses will be overwhelmed. Likewise, if you were to walk into that room and there to be absolute darkness, you couldn't perceive, you wouldn't be aware of the treasures that were there. And so in this physical life, we have both joy and pain, light and darkness, love and hate, all of those things, so that we can perceive the ultimate reality through the vehicle of this physical body. And so in that way, every moment of this life, as painful as it may be, is a gift to us. And even, I have a very dear Baha'i friend who has a daughter who was born severely brain damaged. And this woman and her husband and her family have incorporated this child very much into their lives, and she is unable really to do anything for herself. But it has become such a glorious thing to watch this family, to watch their dedication and their respect for the human spirit that's in that useless body, that it really has greatly inspired everyone that they come into contact with.
It doesn't matter what it looks like. What matters is, how do you perceive it? I have a grandson who was diagnosed with autism when he was 2. He's now almost 6. And he's a beautiful little boy. He's an unusually beautiful little boy. And that's part of it. You know, he's got this incredible facade going. And yet he lost all of his words. And he taught us to communicate in a different way. He taught us to pay attention to him in a different way. Now, my daughter has done an amazing job with him. And this little boy is now in kindergarten, a regular kindergarten, and he's doing fine. But he was a teacher for us, and we knew that. At least I knew it from the get-go. He opened our hearts, he opened our minds, and he took us for a ride with him. And this is the same as every experience in life. Everything that happens to us, there's a gift in it, even if we can't imagine what it could be. You've heard many people who've had cancer talk about what a gift it was for them, because they learned about loving themselves. They learned about opening their hearts and allowing people to do for them. They learned to receive instead of giving themselves away.
So to me personally, I look at that child and of the effects of that child as being really a sign of love in the world. She's a teacher for us all, and she's brought about great and beautiful and really glorious qualities in herself and by her being, you know, by her mere patience and enduring, and in her family, those people who she comes into contact with. So suffering is a challenge not only to the individual sufferer, but also to the community or the society or the people as a whole, you know. We have to realize that. So it's an entirely different way of looking at the at life in the world, because that particular life, you would say, has no great material benefit. But if our true reality is spiritual, and if her being inspires selflessness and devotion and spiritual growth on the part of so many people, this begins to make, to me, a tremendous amount of rational sense.
The first feeling was such joy and such relief and such release that I wanted to share it with all that I had just left, who I love and who love me. So the first learning, the first strength that comes from a weakness, the weakness being ignorance, the weakness being I haven't been there, the weakness being an experience I haven't had yet. And as I go through all of these examples, I want us to notice not only the unthinkable, but as we think about them, imagine that our greatest weaknesses, our greatest ignorance, our greatest holes in our whole self are the opportunities for growth and learning, which become our most authentic strengths and the most authentic expressions of our internal self and our own spiritual growth.
And I realized that I thought that I should be thrown away because I was damaged. And the voice, I got curious, where is this voice coming from? And I look and I can see through this white veil in front of me, and there's a being. And he's male. But he looks kind of feminine. His hair is black, and his hair is up on a bun on the top of his head. And his, I don't think it's odd that his skin is the blue, like a blue poppy. And he has beautiful ornamentation around him and on him. And as beautiful as he is, I can tell he's incredibly powerful. And I'm a little scared, because it feels like if he moved this hand, he could create a mountain. If he moved this hand, he would destroy the mountain. And I couldn't believe I was getting to be in front of such a big, powerful being, and that his focus and attention was on me. And he began to show me images, and he was showing me a flat plane. And the plane started to come together, and it was this kind of violent coming up of a mountain, and it was such a big event, and I was kind of scared and stepping back, and then the mountain started to erode. And the sand was coming down, and pieces were coming down, and then hillsides were coming down. And he was showing me it was making a beach. And he said to me, "Shall we bring down the mountain so you can have the beach?" And I said, "No, I like the mountain and the beach. I love when my feet walk in the warm sand on the beach. That feels so good." And he said, "Destruction makes available the ingredients for creation. Bringing down the mountain is part of making the beach. What looks like total destruction now is making available the ingredients for creation." And I realized he was speaking to me.
I thought that life was happening to me. I thought that everything that was going wrong or not going right was because of God was doing it to me, life was doing it to me. I hadn't a clue that I had any power in all of that. I didn't know that we are an extension of God. I grew up believing and being taught that we are created in the image and likeness of God. Well, I'm here to tell you it's a hell of a lot bigger than that. We are an extension of the God source here on earth. We were created so that the Creator could experience everything that we experience. We were created out of love. And the Creator's always got our back. Spirit's always got our back. And all is well, no matter what it looks like. All is well.
The important thing to remember is when you know and fully know that you are a divine, eternal, spiritual being directly connected to that all-powerful, creative deity, you have nothing to fear. And that is all you need to know.
How do I find my purpose in life? I have a very simple solution. As I told you, I'm a simple person. And so I like very simple solutions. Your only purpose is to be yourself. That's all. And all you have to do is be as you as you can be, shine your light as brightly as you can, and your purpose will unfold before you. Just allow life to unfold before you. And it's that simple. And it's much more important to be yourself than it is to even be positive, because many of us believe, and this is true, many of us believe that we need to be positive.
There is no way that the universe, that creation, could possibly unfold without you fulfilling your purpose. And I know a lot of people struggle with that. What's my purpose? You know, why am I here? Sometimes it seems kind of pointless. Like, you know, I go to my stupid job and I got my stupid boss and I go home and I watch TV and what? There's got to be something more, right? And I've heard lots of answers to that about purpose. I've heard minister after guru, after priest, after pastor, after teacher.
The purpose of life is to give our lives purpose. Do you know? To give our lives the purpose of life, the meaning in life is to give your life meaning. And what is that meaning? What is truly meaningful, you know? Is it the physical accumulation of things and awards and, you know, distinctions and whatnot? Or is it truly meaningful to serve humankind and to grow spiritually? I think that's really what we're here for. In growing spiritually, that's what we do. We come to know and to love God and to contribute to an ever-advancing civilization.
I was told very clearly what our purpose is. Your purpose is to love. It's that simple. Hard to pull off cleanly, but you are here to love. And I'm not just talking about the warm fuzzies. Most people, when you say the word love, they think warm fuzzies. Love is a far more multi-dimensional, complex thing than just the warm fuzzies.
If you're pining to have a near-death experience and you want to experience this, I would say don't. This is not what you want. It may seem like a blessing, but it's often as often a curse as it is a blessing. It leaves one disassociated. It leaves one depressed. I went through a long period of depression. I live a life in non-attachment.
The other thing I was told was that because it's not my time, there's no cheating. The interpretation is no suicide. You are cheating if you do that. He didn't say it was a sin or a crime. I'm not saying that I know if it is or it isn't, because I don't. But he said no cheating. What about that part? You cannot go before it's your time or it's cheating. I don't know why he said that, but he did. So no suicide. And apparently some of us end up doing that.
And you know, I know a lot of people have a fear of death. I have zero fear of death. Matter of fact, I want to go back. I mean, I can't wait. I'm in no hurry. You know, I'm here to dance, I'm here to play this out to you as long as I can. But one thing I can tell you is that suicide won't work. If you're thinking about that, you can just scratch that one off the list, because it's not going to do what you think it's going to do. And I'm not exactly sure what that means. Again, I'm no guru. But I know that was one of the things that I was shown, is that no, you're not gonna, there's no short way around. You're not going to die until you fulfill your purpose.
He was explaining to me that despite what he could offer the people there, that he couldn't fully teach them, because true learning happens in the body. And this is a big deal to me personally, because so much of my life was about wanting to escape the body and wanting that for other people. And I also grew up hearing, you know, when you die, you get to, you know, throw off that, take off that glove, and you get to, you know, be free. And so I kind of thought, like, here is the more negative, there the more positive. And with this understanding in this place that the body is, in a way, there, as hard as it is to see and understand, that true learning happens within the body, because when we are in experience in this form, there's something that evolves within us, that can evolve within us at soul level, that makes the body an important part of the whole, that it, you know, that it isn't one's good and one's bad, but that the two work together in an important way.
I came to realize in the years after my coma, as I got deeper and deeper into trying to understand this, that there are many in this world who have known so much of these truths for a very long time. In fact, this is really about a convergence of human knowledge that will lead into the most amazing and unimaginable future for all of humanity. And it's that convergence of science and spirituality that I talked about, but it has everything to do with understanding that so much of the confusion in this world and of the actual conflict, warfare, and antagonism has to do with a misinterpretation of the writings of religious mystics and prophets, and how that's all been used to separate us in many ways. And yet the message of the Theosophical Society, and certainly a message I came to through my experience, has to do with the fact that we are all truly one. And this is not just about humans. In fact, it's not just about life on Earth. It's far bigger than that.
I repeatedly would question, where are we going? Where's humankind going? Why are we willing to destroy each other? Why are we willing to pile up weapons and annihilate our children and have such hatred towards one another because of the names that we label ourselves, or the colors of our skin, or our ethnic backgrounds? Why were we willing to do that? And because of that, where were we going as a species, as humankind?
People are feeling, I want to do cooperation now. I don't want to keep doing this conflict thing, because it doesn't feel good, and it's not serving me or anybody else. So the whole earth is returning to love, and everything that is happening on the earth is part of that process. Now, it doesn't look like it. If you watch CNN, which is constantly negative news, if you didn't know. So I don't watch it. If I watch what's happening, I can't bear it, and I don't want to be here.
And I became aware that we as humankind existed at the greatest point of our step in evolution that we will ever take in our development, that we existed on the verge of our maturity, that we existed at a point in which we must come to terms with ourselves as individuals in such a way that we can make peace with one another, each soul with one another, and therefore each a nation with nation, each ethnic group with each ethnic group, each religion with each religion. And I realized that we were headed then for a time of great darkness and for a time of great tumult and confusion, that there were two processes going on in this world of existence, as I saw it at this point of this greatest step in our evolution. One was the destruction of the world, and the breaking down into chaos of all systems and institutions and senses of order around us. And the other was the building of a new way of being, a new way of being spiritually and socially in this world as individuals, starting with the smallest of actions and then building from there an entirely new reality, an entirely new society, an entirely new humankind.
Everything that is happening is just encouraging us and supporting us to step into all of who we are. And it's like the whole universe is just there saying, come on, you can do it.
And I stand in front of you now going, you know, the world's a pretty scary place right now. It's a really scary place right now, but there is also so much good. There is so much hope that if we can learn to come together and work with each other and we promote that which we know to be truth. And the one thing that we can hang our hat on is that we are all divine love and wisdom.
So really the only job that you have right now is to raise your frequency. Because when enough people have stepped into the connection to their own divine essence, it's like a net over the earth. As each person steps into the truth of who they are, then they become a light on the net. And when there are enough lights, the whole earth will shift.
One of the things that I saw was that, you know, we all know that we're on the cusp of a shift, right? A shift toward greater consciousness. But at the beginning of any shift, what happens? Chaos. Exactly, right? Because, and that's where we are. This is exactly where we need to be. And what's going on is exactly what we need. It, who knows? I can't say that I get glimpses, but I'm not going to tell you I see the whole picture. I just get little glimpses. But what I see is we're exactly where we're supposed to be, and what's going on, the turmoil that we're feeling right now, is what we need to motivate us right now.
So everything that is playing out in the world is an opportunity for people to choose love. Now, some people only choose love when they've experienced enough hatred. Some people only choose peace when they've really got sick of war. Some people need their lesson in that way. So they're doing it. So they're playing it out. We just let them get on with it and just pray. I just pray for everybody and send the angels in. But if you don't choose your lessons in that way, then don't engage in it.
We are one soul. We are one consciousness. This is all about all of us and all of this world. And it's time to get together and overcome those false boundaries of separation. You are deeply loved and cherished forever. You will be taken care of. You have nothing to fear.
Everybody must be open to bring this new age in. It is about opening your heart and letting it sing through you. It is coming. And it's a matter of all of us. Just open your heart and let it come in. Don't leave. Don't meditate and think this place is a bad place and we're going to get out of here. This is a wonderful place.
And it's going to be even more wonderful. You're here to anchor the light so it can come into this dimension.
Love is the coin of that realm. And the more we can serve as conduits of that love, because our very consciousness is a direct, absolute connection to the divine, infinite healing power of that all-loving source. And by serving as conduits for that and allowing the love to come through us to our fellow beings, to show compassion, forgiveness, mercy, acceptance, that's all that matters.
And again, from my upbringing, the words, I am that I am, became very, very meaningful to me because I was experiencing I am that I am. And knowledge just poured through. I saw my whole life. You know, I saw the divorce. I saw the insecurities it had created. I was unaware of it until this moment. Wow, look what I was putting bandages on. You know, the broken-hearted little boy, all that overachieving, you know, make the team, get the grade, get the girl, get the job, all of that was a big bandage to cover up that insecurity I felt from the little time that mom and dad split up. I saw my brothers. I saw how they had supported me. I saw my friends. I saw the things that I thought were mistakes. And I realized there's absolutely no mistakes. It was all in perfect order. I saw the things that I had done wrong, so to speak. And I knew they were wrong and I did them anyway. And yet in these beautiful arms, all I felt was, look how much we love you. Look how much we support you. Look how much we honor your life, your choices, your decisions, your learning. We love you. It was such an overwhelming, profound, absolute, unconditional love. And in those arms, the I am that I am, I knew I was perfect. And that took me years to say too, but I felt this absolute perfection about my life, about me. And when I say that, I mean all of us. Absolute perfection, absolute order.
And the coin of that realm is love. That unconditional love that goes far beyond the phrase, far beyond those words. And of course, so many who have had near-death experiences and shared death experiences and other similarly spiritually transformative experiences know exactly what that's all about, that unconditional love. And the reason it's so important for all of us to get is because we're here in soul school to learn those lessons of that love. And what we find is that that unconditional love has infinite power to heal.
And I'm just feeling this unconditional love radiating to me and through me and around me. It's like coming home. It's like coming home to a part of myself I didn't know I had. It's like coming home to myself in a way I had never experienced in life. Now, remember, I started out in trouble emotionally, not knowing where my life was going or what I was going to do. I was overwhelmed by life and terrified of making mistakes and, you know, not having the tools and not having support and all of that. And here I am, absolutely enraptured. I felt feelings that I had never felt even as a child, as a newborn with my mother. I felt cherished in a deeper way than I knew you could experience.
And when I began to feel that feeling, it was just this relaxed sense of ease and wholeness and lovability. When I began to feel that, that's when I heard the voice. It was, you know, I call it the voice of my soul, the voice of my God self, the voice of God. And it was a very powerful, very centered voice. And it sounded a lot like me, but the non-neurotic me, right? The me that, you know, didn't feel that he was too fat and he needed to lose 30 pounds. Or the me that was ashamed of himself or that was afraid. It was like a very grounded, centered, whole me, very divine sounding me. And it said to me, beloved, you know a lot about pushing and forcing and fighting and struggling to try to make good things happen for you. But you don't know shit about how to just let your life be good to you. And yes, my soul did say shit. And it said after that, that, you know, life really just wants to be good to you. It wants to be good to you in every area of your life, not just in your health, but in your relationships, in your finances, in your overall life and your work. Life wants to break out the good for you in every area, and you're not letting it. And the key to let all of this happen to you, the key for well-being, is to love yourself fully and to embrace and express more of your soul.
Doesn't matter how successful you've been, how much money you've made, how many kids you've had, you know, what kind of a name you've made for yourself. What matters is, did I touch people? Did I allow them to touch me? Was I living a life of emotional well-being? You know, was I celebrating myself? Was I proud of me? You know? None of us get enough kudos in life. From our parents, none of us got loved the way we wanted to be loved. And that's the way it was set up. But we have the ability to love ourselves and make up the difference. And that's part of what our job is, you know, to be the highest vision of ourselves that we can be. Imagine what the world would be like if we were carrying that energy, as opposed to the insecure little people that we become.
The biggest thing I learned is that life is really a gift, and there's a reason why I'm here, and there's a reason why every single one of you are here. And I want to convey to you the value of your life and how important it is for you to be here right now. I don't stand here before you as some enlightened guru or enlightened master, because I'm certainly no more enlightened than anyone else that sits here in this room. It's just that something happened to me that taught me a few lessons. And these are lessons I wish I knew. I wish somebody told me. And that's why I want to share them with you. And I'm a simple person, so I like to keep my lessons really, really simple. So the first lesson and the most important lesson I learned about life, or what I learned that I believe saved my life, is that I learned that it is extremely important to love yourself. Very, very important. And I cannot stress this enough. And it was the love I felt coming for me that saved my life. I never knew before that, before my near-death experience, that I was supposed to love myself unconditionally.
As I was going through this experience of self-judgment, the voice was saying to me, I know you. I've always known you. You are my creature. I made you. I make you. I love you as you are. I have always loved you. I loved you into being. I love you with all the pain you caused, and I love you without it. I love all of you. And none of this is a surprise to me. I know this about you already.
When I began to feel this sense of oneness, I began to feel this overriding flow of love beyond anything that I can really express. It was just this deep feeling that I was completely held, I was deeply appreciated, and that everything was okay.
I felt this incredible feeling of unconditional love. It was like I was embraced by this feeling of total unconditional love. It's really hard to describe this feeling because it's much more powerful than any kind of love that I've ever experienced in physical life before. it was truly unconditional in that for the first time in my life, I felt I didn't have to do anything to prove myself.
So God swept me and showed me all of Earth. And in showing me all of Earth, I saw that the length of my life was the wink of an eye. In timelessness, time has no meaning. And I saw every human being on Earth individualized. And I saw them loved in the same way that I was loved in heaven. And God said to me, in the way that I love you now, you know that I've always loved you. And it was self-evident to me that God's love is the size of the cosmos, the billions and billions of years that the universe has existed. And the greatest love I'd ever experienced in my life was a speck of dust in comparison. The immensity and infinite love of God is unbelievably overwhelming. And that's the love I'd always been loved with. And I knew that to be true. And I knew that every single human being was loved in the same way. But the difference between the human beings and me was that they couldn't see. They were still in the world with a veil, not knowing the immensity of love. Couldn't know it, not built into the structure, but still loved nonetheless.
We are creating our reality here on this planet. Every last bit of it, we're creating it in our mind. Our images that we create are all our images. We are extremely creative beings. We can sit and do absolutely nothing and be as little as possible if we want to. But it just doesn't seem to be in our nature. We like to create things. If you made the analogy that your life was like a movie that you made, where you picked all of the characters and the actors to play in your movie, and you wrote the script out and said, this is what I want to have happen and how I want it to be, that would be a very good analogy.
Life on Earth, I refer to it as an audiovisual training program. I say a motion picture is a perfect example. You watch the motion picture, you see George Clooney and Matt Damon shooting it out, getting blown to bits, okay? And while you are watching the movie, you're believing it's real. Otherwise, you wouldn't pay for a ticket, right? Unless it was going to seem real to you, if your palms weren't sweating, if your heart wasn't racing while all of this was going on, and if you weren't angry enough to run up to the screen and kill the bad guy. Okay? And then the next day, you find out, oh, they're making another movie. Nobody was harmed at all. It was just a motion picture.
If God is perfect, infinite love, and if the love experience when we leave our bodies is so perfect and Ed was, why do we have to come here to love?
So we can look back at a movie we saw last week and say, that was horrible. But more likely, we look back at a movie we saw last week and say, that was a pretty good flick. Hey, that's kind of what we do when we step out of a life, is say, that was well produced. That had a good director. Who was the director? Oh, I was. Ah.
The answer to that was in part of the download, and the way I kind of explain this is, when I go to movies or to a play, I don't want to know what's going to come up. I want to be surprised, you know? Matter of fact, I want to be scared. That's part of the thing. And see, while when we leave our bodies, we are manifesting pure, infinite love, but it was intangible. It didn't have any skin on. It was as if God wants to be surprised.
The moment that we die, that we leave this physical body, step outside of three-dimensional time-space, and look back, we remember. Oh yeah, before I was born, before I incarnated there, I knew this. I knew I was going to experience what felt like heavy drama, struggle, fear, and I remembered that as soon as I stepped out of the body, I would be whole again. I would not be in that motion picture anymore. So nothing on earth is what it appears to be. Where we're going, where we came from, we have no idea. We have to be open and receptive to a divine perspective of life.
Thank you.